Right, so all of you back. I hope my audio and all is fine. Right, I think now we are good to go. Whatever initial hassles or hurdles had to come have already, we have already surpassed those and we are ahead in our journey. Yes, all of you, all good. Just if some of the students could confirm to me if they are if the chat is okay, or because again it happens that after some time I come to know, okay, oh, there is some change in the video or some problem challenge with the video. So let me just confirm with all of you if it's all fine. I think after 1 or 2 days we'll be like pro with the setup and the class and everything, but it takes little time to adjust. Yes. So open your chat box again. I've started with a fresh video, so you just need to right check it out over there. I think otherwise audio wise I think I'm loud enough. The word audit has been derived from the Latin word audere, which means to hear. Right, so to listen. So audit is the subject where you listen, like you have audio, no? So like audio is listen. So originally that's how audit used to be done, that one person used to be doing the accounting and he used to tell what I have done, and the other person used to listen and say, oh yeah, what you've done is right or wrong. But today you can't go and listen somewhere, okay, how it is done. Today you have to use the data analytics, that is computer-assisted audit techniques for doing the audit. Right, so it's undergone a sea change over there. Right, so all of you back. Yes, everyone, please let me know so that we can start with our discussion on the fundamental principles, and then after that, the discussion on the independence, and then a few sections of the Chartered Accountants Act, and then coming to the schedules to the Chartered Accountants Act 1949. Right, some of the students asked, okay, when would the Google Drive be available? So just 1 or 2 days down the lane, and on a real-time basis we'll be uploading the lectures on Google Drive. So as and when the lectures every day 4 hours recording is done, it will get uploaded. So in next 2 to 3 days the product will be available, so you can also purchase the Google Drive pen drive, or also join in for the live class, whatever suits best for you. So because anyways the first 2 days is on YouTube also, so that much part you can see it live over there, the backup over there, and then join in over here. Right, so I know students are the people who students, they decide everything on their own. Anybody telling anything कुछ ज्यादा नहीं असर होता है, तो ठीक है तुम डिसाइड करो, तुम्हें जैसे भी करना है बस सीए बन जाओ, बस पास हो जाओ, वो इम्पोर्टेंट है ना? तो ऐसा यस, तो आंध्र प्रदेश एंड मध्य प्रदेश एंड दिल्ली एंड ऑल अदर प्लेसेस, हैदराबाद, आर यू ऑल देयर? आई थिंक यू माइट बी सेंडिंग मैसेज इन द ओल्ड चैट बॉक्स दैट यू नीड टू स्टॉप इट एंड देन ओपन इट अगेन एंड देन यू नीड टू सेंड मी अ मैसेज. ठीक है, अदरवाइज दे से नो नो न्यूज इज गुड न्यूज. सो इफ यू इन केस, ओके मैम, ओके मैम, न्यू लाइव स्ट्रीमिंग इज नाउ स्टार्टेड इन द ऐप. ओ माई गॉड, गॉड इज ग्रेट. सो हैप्पी ना? सो नाउ यूट्यूब ऑल्सो, ऐप ऑल्सो, सुपर, गुड गुड गुड, यू कन्फर्म्ड इट ओवर योर, सो गुड. यस विजय गणेश, यस हाउ आर यू? ओके right, so now that I have got a confirmation that things are going in the right direction, let's starts with our discussion on the fundamental principles. Okay, right? Anything we study, like, you know, the basics and all, thought comes to the mind, okay, are, does this come in the exam? Do they ask these questions in the exam? So let us see the question bank, right? So what happens after every discussion on every concept or so? We have a question bank immediately after that. So for chapters, we have a question bank towards the end of the chapter. But for ethics, that after every topic discussion, we have the question bank given over there, right? So like you see this question asked in NOMBER 2022 and NOMBER 2016, right? So ethics, I have not written the marks over there because generally the question is 4 to 5 marks. So 4 mark, 5 mark. जो भी आएगा लिखना पड़ेगा. सो आई हैव नॉट मेंशन द जस्ट टू अवॉइड द नंबर ऑफ वर्ड्स विच वी यूज ओवर देयर, राइट? सो इट इज नाउ इट्स आस्क्ड इन दीज एग्जाम्स एंड व्हेन इट्स आस्क्ड इन द आरटीपी देन आई राइट इट बिफोर दैट दैट आरटीपी सो एंड सो एंड इफ इट्स ओनली मे 18 रिटन दैट मीन्स इट्स आस्क्ड इन द व्हाट यू से इट्स आस्क्ड इन द एग्जाम्स दैट इज इट्स देयर इन द सजेस्टेड ऑफ आईसीएआई, राइट? सो लाइक व्हाट आई टोल्ड यू, अगर आरटीपी का क्वेश्चन है तो उसके पहले लिखा होगा आरटीपी. इफ इट इज अ exam question, then it will be directly written like May 22. Okay, and if nothing is written, May 22 bhi nahi likha hai, koi RTP May 22 bhi nahi likha hai, nothing has been written over there. That means either it is a mock test paper question or it is an institute study material question. Right? So just to avoid the amount of references to be given, you know, then mock test paper, series 1, series 2, yay year, wo year. How does it matter to you when this question is? What matters to you is what is the question and more important, what is the answer? You understand? No, but all the questions have been included. What is important for you? What comes in your exam? Doesn't come in your exam? No problem at all. Okay, right. So these are the references, like RTPs have been specifically mentioned, the suggested questions, and where if you see nothing has been mentioned, then you say ye question kahan se aaya, to ye ya to mock test paper se aaya ya to fir institute, it has come from the institute study material. Okay, right. So yes, do you remember what are the fundamental principles for a professional accountant, or who are professional accountant is the chartered accountant, right? So what are the fundamental principles? We have the integrity, that is straightforward, honest, fair, faithful, you know, faithful and straightforward in his dealing, right? So faithfulness, right? That is the integrity. A person who is one in thought, word and action. You know, in the financial statements of the company, there is a fraud, there is an error. An auditor is saying true and fair. No, this is not integrity. This is not right. You understand? So integrity. Then objectivity. Objectivity means there should be no subjectivity, no getting influenced, no compromising, no bias. Client is telling, hey auditor, if you give clean report, you know, clean report, true and fair, then auditor, we will give you 10 lakh extra, then auditor, next year we'll increase your audit fee by 20 lakh. So they are, you know, tempting you by showing you like lollipop or, you know, something like that over there. So you say, client, don't you know, worry about increasing my fees or so. God is very kind, I have financial abundance, or you know, I have enough that I can make money for my family, for my food, and it's all good, right? So no need for you to tell me that I'll increase your fee if you give this opinion and that and that. No, objectivity hai to hai, nahi to nahi hai, true and fair. If it is true and fair, we give opinion true and fair. If not, then nahin. No, to not. It's not true and fair. Adverse opinion, not true and fair. So objectivity, there should be no bias, there should be no conflict of interest, there should be no compromise of the opinion of the auditor on the basis of what others are saying. Okay, next one, professional competence and due care. That means one, technically he should be very sharp, he should be updated with the developments in the profession. Like there was CARO 1980s, you know, CARO, Companies Auditors Report Order, and it was some 1980s May. Then it came in CARO 2003, then came CARO 2015, then CARO 16, now it's CARO 20. So you can't say, are no client, when I did my CA that time it was CARO 2003, so that's why I don't know CARO 2020. No, continuing development. You can't say jab maine padhai kiya tha to that time it was Companies Act 1956, so I don't know anything regarding Companies Act 2013. No, you can't say that when I studied there was nothing called as LLP, so I don't know LLP Act. No, You have to be updated. That is why you see, for chartered accountants, there is something called as CPE, continuing professional education. Right? You have the unstructured and the structured CPERs. Right? So continuously, like GST, you say, no, for my time it was excise and customs. Now this GST thing, I don't know. No, you have to know it. Right? So that's professional competence. Like AS was there, now Ind AS is there. I can go on with the examples. Right? So that's professional competence. Right. So technically, you have to be very, what do you say, sharp with your knowledge, and then you have to do your work with skill, care, and caution. You have to be competent, cautious, careful while discharging your professional duties. You cannot do your work in a negligent manner. You say, oh, what yaar, so boring. Every year, physical verification of stock, 31st March, so much heat coming over there. I don't want to go to attend. No, you have to go to attend, even if it is 40 degree, 45 degree, 48 degree, because that is due care. You have to do your work with due care. You cannot say, client, you told me your board meeting is 25th April, but I'm not able to finish the work, so I will give you report on 10th of May. No, you can't give the report on 10th May. You have to. You know now, if your exam starts on 1st, you finish studying before that. Do you tell institute that no, start exams from 10th? Nahi na. So you have to do your work with due care. That means you have to be diligent, you have to be careful, you have to be cautious while discharging your professional duties. Next one, confidentiality, not to disclose the secrets of the client. Which client? Present client, at present the clients to whom I'm providing my services, my past clients, and a past client. Okay, last year that I was doing their audit, now they have changed their auditor, so now I'm no longer their auditor. Now I can share the information? No. Chup. There'll be no sharing of information. Keep quiet. And absolutely no sharing of the information, even for your past client. When you are in discussion with some client, which where you might get some work, some consultancy, some audit work. So that is why the client gave you some information. So this is your prospective client. So prospective client also, chup, nothing. So present, past, future, that is prospective client. For all, you need to maintain the confidentiality. Right? Confidentiality, when you can breach it, one, when it is required by law, that you called in the court, right? Summons is there, and that they are telling you in the confession box to tell something regarding the client. Then you have to say, because it is required by law. It is required by law. Right? Or second, where you have taken the prior consent of the client. Like generally, there is a situation where the bankers of the client are asking information from the auditor that you are doing the audit of this company. They are asking us for a loan. What do you think about their financial position? Should we give them a loan or not? The banker calls you to the bank for a meeting. He say, banker, wait, I first need to ask my client, you know, that you are asking for some information regarding my client. If my client is okay, then I will share the information with you. I can't share my working paper. Working paper to my property. But information, let me take the consent of my client. I'll get an approval from them. And then after that, I will share whatever information I can from my end. Okay, so that is, then you can tell the breach the confidentiality. Right? But as such, you know, your brother is starting a new business, and then you come to know about your client doing a wonderful business, and they have a secret production process, and that production process, you explain it to your brother, and then he starts a factory and takes a new patent. No. All that is absolutely not allowed. Right? So confidentiality. Right? So when it is required by law, or when you have taken the consent of the client, then you can disclose the information, otherwise you cannot. Like say peer review, there's something called as the peer review. Like one CA's work is reviewed by another CA. That time, can you share the information regarding the client with the other CA? Yes. So there's some investigation inquiry is going. That time, can you give information regarding your client? Yes. Why? Because it is required by law. So say it's required by law, and that is why I'm giving the information. So should I give the fake information or the authentic information? I'm allowed by law, I'm allowed to give the information. So should I? The client is a loss-making company. Should I say no, it's a profit-making company? No, I have to see that if it is allowed by law also, okay, whatever I'm saying, is it true? Is it authenticated? Am I giving the information to the right person? Right? Who is the recipient of the information? What is the mode of communication? right? You need to check for that, right? So we have a big discussion over there regarding the confidentiality. And professional behavior, what does that mean? It's an avoid. Avoid, that means be away, abstain from any behavior which might bring the disrepute to the profession. Like later on, these examples which I'm talking about will come in our discussion of the clauses. But like CA has taken a loan from the bank. CA loan le sakta hai bank se? Haan, wo bhi to insaan hai na, to loan to he can take. So if you take a loan from the bank, do you need to repay the loan? Yeah, so to repay the loan, will you have to pay the check installments and an EMI will you have to pay? Okay, so now say for paying the EMI of the loan, you have given the checks to the bank and those checks get bounced, you know, bounced, dishonored. Why dishonored they get? Due to insufficiency of funds. Okay, you issued a check of 2 lakh and in your account only 2000 rupees are there. So, or no funds are there. So due to insufficiency of funds, CA ka check got dishonored. Kind of bounced. It's like, arey, this is not professional behavior. CA, you are known to be a financial doctor. At least that much of common sense you should be having. Ke, arey, if I'm issuing a check of 2 lakh, that much money should be there in my bank account. So CA, if you don't keep that money, then they say that it is, if your check gets dishonored, then that's not professional behavior. Client has given you their books of account for doing the audit. So you do the audit of the books of account, do the checking, after that return it to the client. But you're saying, no, no, client, I admire, I adore your books of account, I just want to keep them for myself. Client has paid the fees. There is no question of exercising audit lien. And anyways, the Ethical Standard Board of ICAI has said that audit lien is now not allowed. And anyways, their audit lien, electronic books of account, everything is on the data. Which times are you in wherein you can exercise audit lien? Practically impossible. And so CA is saying, no, no, client, I really like your books of account a lot. I have, even though the audit is over, this I'm going to keep it with me only. I'll not give it to you. They say, arey, ye kya behavior hai? This is not professional behavior. Right? He's telling them that he's going to a bank every day, asking the bank for a loan. And bank is not ready to give him the loan. So then he finally tells bank, see, manager, agar loan diya na, to your return and your staff ka return, next 2 years, I will file it free of cost. Immediately, next minute, loan sanctioned. This is not professional behavior. It might be in your professional life or it might be in your personal life. But bhai, ye professional behavior nahi hai. This is not considered to be professional behavior. Right? So it says avoid any behavior which might bring the discredit or the disrepute to the profession. Okay, people are pointing out, ah, CA aisa karta hai. Oh, CA did like this. Aisa kisi ne bolna nahi chahiye. You understand that? That is professional behavior. Right. So these are the fundamental principles. What are the fundamental principles? Integrity. Arey, I'm not able to hear your voice. Also, ma'am, you're sitting thousands of kilometers away. How you'll be able to hear? You don't know. I have a superpower when it comes to the student. When you say it over there, I can listen to it over here. And when you're smiling, when you're sitting like this, crooked, making faces, sab pata chalta hai. Sab pata chalta hai. What is going on in your mind? Don't, doesn't matter physically you are there in front of me or not. So let me hear your voice. Still, there's someone like, you know, I won't say. Let me see. Koi to bol do. Dheere se, man mein bol do, man mein. Integrity. What are the fundamental principles? Integrity. Objectivity, professional competence and due care, confidentiality, professional behavior. Theek hai? Yes, everyone, is it fine? Do you know what are the fundamental principles? Integrity, objectivity, professional competence and due care, confidentiality and the professional behavior. Okay, for you to get the maximum advantage of the class and to gain a mastery over the subject of audit, on first day, I don't want to disappoint you or annoy you, but I have to tell you the fact, right? So the fact is, audit is quite a tricky paper. Right? For some, it works like a cakewalk, like, you know, it just happens or so, like they are able to write and get convinced with what is written, the wavelength matches with the examiner and done. And for some, you know, it becomes like the, you know, the trouble point. It becomes like the trouble spot over there. Okay? They found, you know, audit. I thought FR is difficult, SFM is difficult. Ye to is crazy. I get 60, I get 54, I get 55. This audit, my marks are only not moving ahead. Not getting only. Talk to 10 people who've already cleared group one and ask them regarding their journey of audit. Yes, I can confidently tell you regarding out of those 10, 6 to 7 students would say that yes, audit is, you can't take it for granted. There is special attention required. It's not as easy as you assume it to. Yes, even though how much amount of practical exposure you have or whatever, you have to give it, like just the way you study other subjects, you have to give that devoted time for audit also. Okay, and I'm so happy that I like, in 2009 when I decided to teach a subject, I, with God's grace, I happened to select a subject which is in the syllabus. Okay, right, so I don't know, otherwise I would have to prepare altogether a new subject or whether I would have continued teaching or no. But anyways, why talk about it? Because audit will always be there. So whenever I say this to anybody, वो बोलते हैं ऐसा क्यों बोलते हो, ऑडिट तो हमेशा रहेगा. मैंने बोला हाँ, DT, IDT, accounts audit, ये तो they'll always be installed in the software of the syllabus. Okay, right, so for you to get the best advantage of this class, right, so audit is a tricky subject. You have to tackle it well, and for you to get the best advantage of the class, whatever I discuss today, like I'll be putting the encrypted notes, so through the encrypted notes till the time you don't get the hard copy of the notes, but I want you to read. Just read whatever I discussed with you in class today. Do the markings, whatever notes you have to make, you please make it. And again, I generally tell you what we are going to discuss on the next day. So just scan through that, so that you can get the maximum advantage of the class, right? So that you get the maximum advantage of the class. One more, maybe let your textbook come, then I'll just mention it now. Okay, what you need to do, like these are your textbook, right? TB is textbook and NB is your notebook, right? So in your textbook, say there is a concept which is there on page number 19.3, example. Okay, and in your notebook, say you're writing it on page number 3. So one, in your notebook, you have to give all the 1, 2, 3, 4, up to 200, you have to give the page numbers, right? And say here you have written regarding the, in your notebook, here it is where you have written regarding the fundamental principles, and here in the textbook it is over here. It's an example there, you may. It's over here, the fundamental principles, right? So what you give, do in your textbook, you give a reference of your notebook NB page 3, NB 3, and in your notebook you give a reference of textbook page 19.3. Right, so that later on, either when you're studying from the textbook or the notebook or both together, you know where you need to refer through. Right, so this I know certainly during your articleships you would have done such a referencing work, right? Just generally the one of the main work which is what you say allotted to the articles. Okay, right, so you do such referencing from trial balance to schedule to balance sheet and all of that, ledgers, trial balance and all of that, right? So you can give such references which will make it convenient for you at a later point of time to refer to the subject. Okay, right, so we have just finished our discussion regarding the yes, the fundamental principles, right? What are the fundamental principles? Integrity, right, then objectivity. Right, integrity, objectivity, professional competence and due care, confidentiality, and the professional behavior. Okay, right, and then we come to the discussion regarding the threats to the independence. That is independence and the threats to the independence of the auditor. Okay, right, so just taking some time to scroll back, but yeah, we are reaching there. Yeah, so integrity, right? So I told you these are the fundamental principles. So a professional accountant, so I told you a chartered accountant over here is referred to as the professional accountant, shall comply with the principle of integrity, which requires an accountant to be straightforward and honest. Right, honest, right? So no fake, no getting convinced, and no giving the false information, right? So it means fair dealing and truthfulness, right? So being, what do you say, very upfront, being very, एकदम स्ट्रेट फॉरवर्ड, in whatever you say, right? So not knowingly, you know that the client financial statements, there is a fraud, there is an error, and still you are saying true and fair. You know that they have not given the disclosures of contingent liability, still you are saying that the financial statements have given all the disclosures. Nay, don't associate yourself with such type of financial statements. Not knowingly be associated with report, certificate, communication, returns and other information where he believes that the information is a false information or there is a misleading statement. You know that the company is coming up with a new plant, manufacturing plant next year. No new manufacturing plant is coming, but they've just written it. And so contains a materially false information or contains information that is provided negligently. That next year the company may come up with an IPO. Aise hi kisi sun liya aur likh diya ki IPO aa sakta hai. No. No, negligently or omits, that means not given, or obscures. So they write there are no material fights going on with the income tax department. There are no material income tax cases which are going on. Abhi aise likh ke to lagta hai ki phir matlab what is going on? There is nothing that serious. So it's like, you know, it's very ambiguous, the information. There is no clarity. It's obscuring. Right, so omits or obscures, that means they are not telling it clearly. Like you're asked, you know, yesterday, you know, why were you late? So you say, no, yesterday, you know, there was a, I couldn't come on time. Arey, toh wo toh mujhe pata hai. Main wo hi pooch rahi hu na ki why were you late? No, I couldn't come on time, you know, because there was some issue, so I couldn't come on time. So you're obscuring the information. You're not telling me the reason ke why you couldn't be, why you were late. Right, so omits or obscures the required information, that such omission or obscurity would be misleading. So financial statements kaise hone chahiye, which give the users the information on the basis of which they can take the decision, which leads them to take the right decision. And here the financial statements are misleading. So if they are misleading, see, you disassociate. You don't associate with such an engagement. Right, so that's the integrity. Right. Second requirement is the objectivity, that is not to compromise on his professional or business judgment, and no getting bias, conflict of interest or undue influence of the others, right? And not to undertake any professional activity where it unduly influences his judgment. A client is telling that CA will increase your audit fee, CA we will appoint you as an auditor, or we'll give you audit of 10 of our subsidiary companies, you please give a clean report. CA says, please don't bring me under pressure like this, right? No undue influences. Right, so in the beginning of the class I had mentioned to you about the book, and I told you that this book is a all in one, 3-in-1, 4-in-1, jo bhi bolna hai. Okay, one, it is your entire theory notes. Second, it works like your scanner, because I told you the test your knowledge is exhaustive at the end of the book. Entirely all the questions are from past and are there over there. And third, it also works as a compact, or what you say, a quick referencer book for you, because I have highlighted the important words. And that's the reason I have decided that only color books to be printed and no black and white. As of now, that's the decision taken. Maybe it increases the costing by a few rupees, even the price of the book. But I think it's a good investment. Like the book has been charged at 1495, which is 1500 for some 840 pages over there, two modules, one in two, plus it has the courier charges and all of that. So it's the, you know, the raw material, labor, overheads, and so on, and no counting of the amount of hours or, you know, effort which I have put. If I put that, then I think probably the book value should be much higher. But no, the purpose is for you to get the best for the subject of audit, right? So so you can, you know, do selective reading. Then sometimes what happens when you read too much, chota chota chota, little, then you are not able to write these sentences in the exam. So you have the entire content also, where you read the entire sentences when you have the time. When you want to revise, you see only the keywords. So that's how it works. Then you also see how the questions are coming in the exam. So all those purposes get served. That's what I have kept in my mind while preparing the book. And also I've kept it in the same sequence of the ICS study material, like 19 chapters over there. Similarly, we have the 19 chapters, module 1, 0 to 11, and module 2, 12 to 19. Okay, right. So objectivity. Then PCDC. What is PCDC? Ye kitna mast likha hai. How beautifully they've written. Attain and maintain. So attain means what? You say GST was never there before. So now it has come. यू अटेंड द नॉलेज ऑफ जीएसटी एंड मेंटेन कि कारों का नॉलेज यू ऑलरेडी हैड बट नाउ देर इज अ चेंज इन कारो सो नाउ यू अपडेट योर नॉलेज रिगार्डिंग कारो सो अटेंड एंड मेंटेन प्रोफेशनल नॉलेज एंड स्किल एट द लेवल रिक्वायर्ड टू एंश्योर दैट द क्लाइंट और द एम्प्लॉइंग ऑर्गेनाइजेशन एवरीवेयर दे यूज दिस वर्ड क्लाइंट एम्प्लॉइंग ऑर्गेनाइजेशन क्लाइंट इज फॉर सी ए इन प्रैक्टिस एंड एम्प्लॉइंग ऑर्गेनाइजेशन इज फॉर सी ए इन सर्विस Right, client is for CA in practice, and employing organization is for CA in service. Right, receives the competent professional service based on the current technical professional standards and the relevant legislation. And so currently, whatever standards have been issued, like I told you, the forensic accounting standards, the auditing standards, the social audit standards, and the current legislation, that whatever laws, regulations are applicable right now. So this is your PC. And then you have your DC. What is DC? Due care. Act diligently. That means carefully. Right? In accordance with the applicable technical and professional standards. Right, so all the publications which are to be followed by the chartered accountant, all the laws and regulations. Okay, right, so it says serving clients and employing organizations with professional competence requires the exercise of the sound judgment. That means, you know, how do I follow a particular auditing standard? Like you have to do the audit as per the standards, but how to apply that standard that requires the judgment, right? Also, he has to be updated, continuing awareness of the technical, professional and the business developments, right? He has to develop and maintain the capabilities. It's you cannot say, oh client, I don't know blockchain, toh bhi kaise kare, you guys toh are using blockchain. So no, you have to update your knowledge regarding blockchain. Your client is having a generative AI, artificial intelligence, and they are having IoT, Internet of Things. They are having machine learning, they are having deep learning or something. So you say, nahin, I don't know. So no, don't know is not the answer. You have to know it. Right, so develop and maintain. Right, so again, he has a responsibility to act in a careful, thorough, and on a timely basis. Like I told you, no, client deadline is 25th April. You can't finish your work on 10th May. You have to finish your work on time. Right, and also you have to ensure that not only you are competent, the people working under you, like you are a partner in a firm, and under you there are 20 people working. Even they should be competent. You have to take reasonable steps to ensure that for those working in a professional capacity. Under the accountant's authority have the training and the supervision. So people who are working under you, even they have the training and the supervision, right? So that is why you see in these big fours or CA firm that training seminar hote rehte. They keep on conducting trainings and seminars on different topics. Right. So that is regarding the PCDC, that is the professional competence and due care. Next one is the confidentiality, that is not to disclose the secrets of the client unless required by law or taken the prior consent of the client. So it says over here, disclosure is required by law or it is permitted by law and authorized by client or there is a professional right or duty to disclose. Right, professional, so required by law or the prior consent of the client. Right, what did I say? You have to maintain your confidentiality. Again, it says for professional and employment relationship. That means for CA in practice also and for CA in service also. Then you have to maintain confidentiality for your correct present clients, then for your past clients and also for your future clients, that also for your prospective clients, for all you need to maintain the confidentiality, right? So you have to be alert to the possibility of an inadvertent disclosure. So what happened, like, you know, Starbucks, you are having coffee with your friend and all of you doing articleship in a different big four, one doing in PwC, KPMG, EY, Deloitte and all of that. Each of you have been put on different assignment. And then, you know, one of your friends says, are mere client ke yahi accounting ka issue ho gaya. You say, are you to don't, this is nothing. You know, my client to such a big problem happened in their purchases, their supplier, he did a 20 crore fraud, what to tell you, what headache yesterday till 2 o'clock that matter was only discussed. So you were just trying to have a, you know, discussion with your friend, didn't have any intention to tell it aloud to the world, but nahin, even by mistake it should not happen. And you say, ma'am, it's a mistake, that's what they say, mistake is not allowed. Even an inadvertent disclosure, including in a social environment, particularly to a close business associate or an immediate or a close family member. Like, you know, wife asks in the evening, what happened today? You look very stressed, or you know, what happened? Or you know, shouting at the kids after coming back home or something. Then say, oh no, that client, you know, big accounting issue, they've got a notice from the department. Nahin, you can't say that. You are not supposed to say that. You should not say that. Right? So be alert. है ना, तो मतलब जागते रहो, लाइक यू हैव टू बी अलर्ट ऑलवेज, बट ऑल्सो इज अ प्रोफेशनल स्केप्टिसिज्म ऑल्सो ना, बींग अलर्ट, क्वेश्चनिंग माइंड तो है ही, बट बींग अलर्ट टू कंडीशन विच में इंडिकेट अ पॉसिबल मिसस्टेटमेंट ड्यू टू एरर और फ्रॉड. राइट, मेंटेन कॉन्फिडेंशियलिटी ऑफ द इन्फॉर्मेशन. ओके, मेंटेन कॉन्फिडेंशियलिटी फॉर द प्रोस्पेक्टिव क्लाइंट, देन नॉट टू डिस्क्लोज अनलेस देर इज अ लीगल और अ प्रोफेशनल ड्यूटी, नॉट टू यूज द इन्फॉर्मेशन फॉर द पर्सनल एडवांटेज. Can anybody tell me one term के personal advantage के लिए information use करते हैं, उससे what can that be also called as? That information is used for the personal advantage. You have a technical. Should I give you a hint? Let me try if it comes without the hint. नहीं आया तो then I give you hint. हाँ, personal advantage के लिए confidential information use कर लिया. Yes, anybody? Tick tick one. Type 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 quickly. I'll not say tick tick two. Either you are typing. I've written hello all, welcome back. You know that is the chat box where you need to reply to me. Theek hai? Anybody over here? Yes, what does it mean? What is the term called as? Yes. Where is the person from Pune? It is insider trading. Right? So insider trading, like, you know, before the share market or before they come to know regarding, you know, outsiders come to know what is the profit of the company. You have the financials of the company in your hand. And based on that, you tell your friend to purchase shares and then you make a huge amount of profit over there. It says, no, not allowed. Yes. So personal advantage. Exactly. That's the point I'm saying. Yes. Insider trading. Okay. Right. Then not to use the information after the relationship has ended. मतलब क्या, फॉर पास्ट क्लाइंट्स, राइट, ऑल्सो फॉर योर पास्ट क्लाइंट्स, एंड टेक रीजनेबल स्टेप्स. सो व्हाट कि द पीपल वर्किंग अंडर यू, जनरली फर्स्ट ईयर आर्टिकल्स, बिग चैटर बॉक्स, चु 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 चु, दे आर जस्ट सो एक्साइटेड, सो न्यू, ऑलवेज 11 12th में कॉलेज में, देन फाउंडेशन तो वेरी सिंपल एंड मासूम इनोसेंट वंस ओवर देयर, देन इंटर दे डू क्लासेस लिटिल बिट, दे are groomed and you know become little more matured over there, and then they start with articleship and all of that, and now it's a new exposure. You know, they've always been in classroom and all of a sudden in the office and everything, they're so fascinated looking at the buildings and the computers and the people coming and they're dressing and everything all of a sudden, and they, you know, then they start sharing information and then they say, ori, that happened, you know, then this, the client told me this is how they do the work, this is how they do the accounting. No, your engagement partner, your audit partner, your chartered accountant has to take care, like, not only the articles but even the professionals working under them, right? They maintain the requirement of the confidentiality, they abide by the requirement of the confidentiality. Okay, right, then what does it say? It's a professional duty when it is not prohibited by law. Like, what is not prohibited by law? I told you, as to comply with the requirement of peer review or the quality review. At quality review, there is a separate quality review board which has been set up by the central government, right, wherein the central government appoints the technical reviewer to check the quality of the services provided by the CA firm. So in that case, again, they will go through your client information, any inquiry or investigation, any legal proceedings, or to comply with any technical requirement or ethics requirement. So simple, whenever it is required by law, you are allowed to disclose the information, right? And when you're giving the information, what you need to see, whether it is in the interest of the party, whether it is known and substantiated, what is the type of communication and to whom it is addressed. You understand, no? Like, this is philosophy, so not much of philosophy, little, huh? They say, na, okay, whenever you have to say anything, it's difficult to apply, but it's good to know. At least you should be knowing so that at least sometimes you apply it in your life. Okay, whenever you are in a dilemma, okay, whether I should say this or not say this, it says there are three things which you need to consider, right? And then after you put the three filters and after you get a tick for all the three ticks, then you can decide whether you should say it or no. First is it true? Okay, whatever you want to say to your friend, to your anybody, whether it is true. Okay, so you say, I don't know whether it's true, then out. Don't need to tell it. Is it true? Okay, if it is true, then you need to check, is it kind? Is it something like somebody told bad about something and that is true and that you want to say? So that's not kind. So again, eliminate it. No need to say. So you say it's kind also, okay? Somebody praised somebody, right? So is it true? Is it kind? And then third, is it necessary? You know, is it like really required for you to tell it? You say, nee, it's okay if I don't tell it also. So if it's okay, then don't tell. So these are the three conditions. You know, it says, is it true? Is it kind? Is it necessary? Okay, so will you apply it? You'll remember it? Okay, ठीक है. First remember this ethics over here. Okay, professional behavior, right? So avoid any behavior, है ना? Avoid, be away from any such behavior which might bring the discredit to the profession, right? So be in a, yes, do not do any activity, not knowingly engage in any occupation activity that might impair, that means affect, and a badly affect, right? The integrity, objectivity, or the good reputation of the profession. Right, so conduct his affairs in the with remaining within the boundaries, right, of the professional behavior and outside the boundaries of the professional or the other misconduct, right? And that is why it says a chartered accountant should not make any exaggerated claims, right, as to the services they are able to offer, the qualification or the experience. You know, I am the best statutory auditor in the country. I am the fastest auditor in the country. It says, nay, don't make such exaggerated claims. Don't make any disparaging references or unsubstantiated comparison. As compared to their firm, we complete our audit in 10 days. As compared to their firm, we pay 40% more salary. As compared to their firm, we have the latest version of the laptops or the iPads. No, it says no unsubstantiated comparisons to be done. And no direct or indirect measures to advertise any professional or other facts that is in violation of the advertisement guidelines. We are going to have a great discussion on the advertisement guidelines for a chartered accountant, which we will discuss later. Right, so everybody, all good? Yes, happy for you that happy news for you that we've completed with the fundamental principles, right? See, my purpose or what thought is in my mind, okay? So much of time we spend with the concept in the class or we discuss it so elaborately in the class, okay? If you directly happen to see some MCQ or case study or theory question in the exam, you should be able to write. And you should be able to write. You should be that well versed with the topic. Okay, now coming to the next discussion over there, yes, which is regarding the independence of the auditor. And what did I tell you? Independence of the auditor is non-negotiable. And you cannot say थोड़ा इंडिपेंडेंट है, सेमी इंडिपेंडेंट है, हाफ इंडिपेंडेंट है, हाफ यूके के पास है, हाफ ब्रिटिश के पास है. नहीं, जैसे इंडिया वी से ना फुल्ली इंडिपेंडेंट कंट्री, नॉट लाइक हाफ विथ ब्रिटिश और सो. नो, सो इंडिपेंडेंस, राइट? व्हाट डज इट से? इट इज नॉन निगोशिएबल. व्हाट इज द डेफिनेशन ऑफ इंडिपेंडेंस से? इट्स इंडिपेंडेंस इम्प्लाइज, इट मीन्स दैट द जजमेंट ऑफ अ पर्सन, you know, my judgment or any person's judgment is not subordinate to the wishes or directions of another who might have engaged him or for his own self-interest. Simple. Okay? Your decision making is not subordinate to the wishes or direction, because client is telling you, CA, please say true and fair. That is why you're saying true and fair. So your decision making is subordinate. Or client is not telling you anything, but you know that if I don't say true and fair, next year they will not appoint, reappoint me. That is why you're saying true and fair. So for his own self-interest. So what does it say? Independence implies that the judgment of a person is not a subordinate. You say, whatever it be, this is what I want to say, and this is what I will say, and this is what I have said. That the judgment of a person is not a subordinate to the wishes or directions of another who might have engaged him or for his own self-interest. It says independence is the keystone. It's the Aadhaar Stambh. It's the keystone on which the respect and dignity of the profession is based. It is the respect, राइट, द कीस्टोन ऑन विच द रिस्पेक्ट एंड द डिग्निटी के इतना क्या वैल्यू है, मतलब ऐसा क्या सीए ने बोल दिया तो क्या, अरे सीए के वर्ड्स को बहुत वैल्यू है ना, इट्स द रिस्पेक्ट ऑन इफ द सीए हैज सेड इट, देयर इज क्रेडिबिलिटी टू इट इफ द सीए हैज सेड इट, इट्स लाइक अ ब्रांड, यू नो, लाइक इफ यू सी दैट यू नो यू बाय द व्हाट यू से, यू जस्ट बाय योर वॉच on the street, or you buy your watch from Titan, you know that's a brand, it's credible, you know, it's authentic, it's going to be good that way, right? So anybody is saying true and fair, no, CA has said true and fair, there is credibility associated with it, right? So independence, okay, now this independence of the auditor, it says it should not only be of the mind but it should also be the independence of the appearance. Okay, what does this mean? Okay, now section 141 of the Companies Act 2013, let me try my luck. More specifically, I want section 141 subsection 3, inter audit, agar, you know, by chance, if you section 141, not 143, section 141 subsection 3. Kya hai? Companies Act, obviously, here I'm talking about the Companies Act 2013, section 141, subsection 3. You know it. You don't know it. Any of syllabus, mein, you know, company audit was such a near dear topic for me for discussion. Now for November 23 students, I have uploaded it all on YouTube because it's not applicable for the in the new syllabus or so. So, theek hai. Yes. हाँ करेक्ट, व्हाट इज इट, यस इट इज द डिस्क्वालिफिकेशन ऑफ द कंपनी ऑडिटर. ओके, व्हेन यू कैन नॉट बी अपॉइंटेड एज एन ऑडिटर ऑफ अ कंपनी, राइट, व्हेन यू कैन नॉट बी अपॉइंटेड एज एन ऑडिटर ऑफ अ कंपनी इफ योर बॉडी कॉर्पोरेट अदर देन एलएलपी, राइट, ऑफिसर और एम्प्लॉई ऑफ द कंपनी और अ पर्सन हु इज अ पार्टनर और हु इज इन द एम्प्लॉयमेंट ऑफ एन ऑफिसर और एम्प्लॉई ऑफ द कंपनी और होल्डिंग एनी सिक्योरिटी इंटरेस्ट इनडेटेडनेस गारंटी, है ना, और हैविंग एनी बिजनेस रिलेशनशिप और रिलेटिव इज अ डायरेक्टर और इज इन द एम्प्लॉयमेंट एज अ डायरेक्टर और अ केएमपी ऑफ द कंपनी, राइट, सो लॉट ऑफ होल्डिंग मोर देन 20 कंपनी ऑडिट्स कन्विक्टेड फॉर फ्रॉड और प्रोवाइडिंग द 144 सर्विसेज, राइट, सो दैट इज द डिस्क्वालिफिकेशन ऑफ द कंपनी ऑडिटर. एनी वेज, एंड ऑल दीज डिस्क्वालिफिकेशन ऑफ द कंपनी ऑडिटर हैव बीन पुट in order to ensure the independence of the auditor. Okay, if I have to do the audit of a company, like say the company I have to audit is Growth Limited. Okay, now if I have to do the audit of Growth Limited, whether I can hold a single equity share of Growth Limited? Can I hold a single equity share? No. My partners of my firm, can they hold any equity share? No. My relatives, they can hold up to the face value of rupees. Up to the face value of rupees 1 lakh, right? Relative can hold, but I cannot hold, my partner cannot hold a single equity share, right? So that is in order to ensure the independence of the auditor. Okay, so I am asking you, okay, are you independent? You know, you are doing the audit of Growth Limited. I am asking you, are you independent as an auditor? What you are saying? Yes, ma'am, I'm absolutely independent. I'm asking you and you are saying, okay, yes, I am absolutely independent. This is what you think. So that is independence of mind. That's independence of mind. Now what I will do, I will ask a RITP. Who is RITP? I'll ask a reasonable and informed third party. I will ask a reasonable and informed a third party, okay, whether they think whether the auditor is independent. And I ask them, okay, do you think this auditor, I'm asking him, is are you independent? He says, no, I'm so independent too. What do you think? Reasonable and informed third party. It may not be a CA. It may not be anybody in your firm. But that person is reasonable and informed. So they say, yeah, yeah, even I think, you know, this auditor is independent. So then in that case, there is independence in appearance also. In that case, there is independence in appearance also. Then you ask the third party, RITP, reasonable and informed third party, is this auditor independent? He says, oh, he says, what do you you're joking. This is the most non-independent auditor I have ever seen. Oh my God, yesterday only he purchased 50,000 shares and he made 50 lakh rupees out of this. He just thinks in his mind, I have done nothing wrong, but I'm telling you, he's not at all independent. So in that case, there is no independence of the appearance. Classic example for me to associate this independence of mind and appearance is your study. So instead of independence, let's put the word study over there. Studying as per your mind. I ask you, what do you think? Are you studying? You say, yes, ma'am, I'm studying, ma'am. Every day studying, ma'am. CA final, not a joke. Okay, studying. So as per your mind, you're studying. I ask your parents, how is your child studying? They say, our child is studying? Oh my God. We never knew that our child is studying also. Full day we see video game, cricket, and social media, Netflix, and all whatever, all different channels over there. Never seen by mistake also studying. And so does it appears to others that you are studying? No. But as per your mind, you say, no, I'm studying. Right. So what does it say? Okay, independence of a CA, mind का तो होना ही चाहिए. Okay? पहले तो अपने मन को समझना चाहिए ना. अगर मन को ही पता है तो वो तो गलत हो गया ना. बट सिर्फ मन को पता हो के नहीं चलेगा. ओनली योर माइंड नोइंग इट इज नॉट इनफ. नॉट इवन नॉट एनी बडी वॉकिंग ऑन द स्ट्रीट, बट अ रीजनेबल एंड इन्फॉर्म थर्ड पार्टी शुड ऑल्सो थिंक यस यार दिस ऑडिटर इज इंडिपेंडेंट. Do you understand that? Independence. Because if there is no independence of mind, there is no independence of appearance, the integrity, the objectivity, and the professional skepticism of the chartered accountant will be compromised. The integrity, objectivity, and the professional skepticism, that questioning mind of the chartered accountant, these will be compromised. You cannot be having integrity. You cannot be considered to be objective. You cannot maintain your professional skepticism if you are not independent. You understand, everyone? Everybody, are you understanding the concept of independence of mind and independence in appearance? Okay, just one more point. Just because you comply with the requirement of company law, that does not necessarily mean that you are independent. Like, example, company law says that I should not hold a share if I have to do the audit of Growth Limited. My partner should not hold the share. My relative should not hold share exceeding rupees, face value rupees 1 lakh. So I cannot hold, okay. Partners cannot hold, okay. Relative, there is a limit. Okay, does company law say that friend cannot hold a share? Does company law say that your friend also cannot, if you are doing the audit, your friend cannot hold? Nobody will become your friend only then. So friend can hold, right? Even though if I am doing the audit of Growth Limited, can my friend hold a share of Growth Limited? Right. So through my friend, I do insider trading. What term you told me? And I tell Lori, I'm telling you, I can't invest, Ray. Some restriction is there for me, but you purchase share and then we do 50-50 later on. So no, then independence of mind is not there. Are you understanding that? There's no independence of mind. Your mind is thinking of creative ideas over there. Right. So independence means that the judgment of a person is not subordinate to the wishes or directions of another or for his own self-interest. Right? And independence, the code of ethics requires not only independence of the mind, but also the independence of the appearance. And now, so do I need to check whether a auditor or a chartered accountant is he independent or not? Should I check or do I need to check? Okay, when I'm doing an audit as an auditor, is the auditor independent or not? Okay, look, so when I say a particular word now, you have to tell me what comes to your mind. I will say a particular place now, and the moment I mention that place, you have to tell me what comes to your mind. Like, say example, I say Agra. Yes, let me see some message on the chat box. If I say Agra, what thought comes to your mind? I say Agra. Any thought? Maybe the live streaming, the latex time by the time it reaches there. If I say Agra, there's some Agra ka Ghagra, some songs they make nowadays, I don't know. Okay, anyways, not about the Ghagra, but anything else that you remember? Yes, what comes to your mind is the Taj Mahal, right? The moment I say Agra, the first thought, which generally, like, it's associated, no, in your mind, it's associated with the Taj Mahal, right? You know that it's one of the wonders of the world, and what a magnificent work of architecture done of marble over there, right? But done after Mumtaz was dead, and not when she was alive. So she never knew, right, what was made in her, what was made for her. Okay, so love needs to be expressed when the person is alive and not later. But anyways, that's their concern regarding what they have to do, what they had done, what they thought was right. Anyways, right now over here, the moment I say Agra, it says Taj Mahal. Like, the thought which comes to your mind is Taj Mahal. Similarly, when the moment I say independence, के ऑडिटर को इंडिपेंडेंट होना चाहिए, दैट वी टॉक अबाउट द इंडिपेंडेंस ऑफ द ऑडिटर, देन द नेक्स्ट वर्ड कमिंग टू योर माइंड हैज टू बी वेदर देर आर एनी थ्रेट्स टू द इंडिपेंडेंस ऑफ द ऑडिटर. Whether there are any threats, dhoka, khatra, danger. You understand? Danger to the independence of the auditor. Is there any threat to the independence of the auditor? I am telling you, all the examples of the disqualifications given under Section 141, Subsection 3 are examples of threats to the independence of the auditor. If I am an officer employee of the company, it is a threat to the independence. If my partner, office, what do you say? My partner employee is an officer employee of the company, it's a threat to independence. If I am holding a share, it's a threat. If I'm indebted, it's a threat. If I'm giving a guarantee, it's a threat. It's a threat to the independence of the auditor, right? So as an auditor, if you have to check the independence of the auditor, you have to start with first checking to identify whether there is any threat. तो पहले क्या करना है? आइडेंटिफाई करो कि कुछ थ्रेट है या नहीं. आइडेंटिफाई, इज देयर एनी थ्रेट टू द इंडिपेंडेंस ऑफ द ऑडिटर. इफ थ्रेट हैज बीन आइडेंटिफाइड, right, say you identify the threat. Now what you do, you need to evaluate the threat. You need to evaluate it. Okay, what is the threat and so. Then after you evaluate it, you have to address the threat to the independence of the auditor. And finally, you need to put the safeguard, you know, so that that threat doesn't come to the independence of the auditor. Right, so one by one, now we are going to talk about these 4 points over there. Identify the threat, evaluate the threat, address the threat, and put the safeguards. Right? Everybody with me? Identify, evaluate, address, and the safeguard. Right. But before I come to these discussions, like identify the threat, we have to first understand that there are five types of threats to the independence of the auditor. The code of ethics have divided the threats to the auditor under five types, right? Five types of threats to the independence of the auditor, right? What are the five types of threats to the independence of the auditor? You have the F, S, S, A, I, right? F, S, S, A, I. What is F, S, S, A, I? F stands for the familiarity threat, right? Familiarity threat. S stands for the self-interest threat. I hope you're writing with me, everyone. Right? Self-interest threat. Next, S stands for the self-review threat. A stands for the advocacy threat. Threats it could be, and I stands for the intimidation threat, right? The intimidation threat, right? So we have five types of threats to the independence of the auditor: familiarity threat, self-interest threat, self-review threat, advocacy threat, and the intimidation threat, right? Everybody, all fine, everything going fine, you're able to follow me, sab theek hai na? You're listening, right? encrypted video students, I am somehow not able to see your chat, so probably you need to, stop and start the chat again, or I don't. Let's see how it could happen, but let me try starting the chat again. So it's lecture 1B, right? Yeah. So I've come to the chat. Yes. Yes, all of you listening to me? Is it all going fine for all of you? Okay, right. So there are five types of threats to the independence of the auditor. That is the familiarity threat, self-interest threat, self-review threat, advocacy threat, and the intimidation threat. Familiarity. That means you're too familiar. Familiar means familiarity, theek hai. Too familiar or too sympathetic to the client interest. Then that is familiarity threat. Company law 2013, as compared to the 1956 law, brought in a new concept of the rotation of the company auditor. That certain classes of companies, like listed companies and then 10 crore, 50 crore, 50 crore, right? Listed companies and certain classes of companies, they cannot appoint a firm for more than 2 terms of 5 consecutive years and an individual for more than 1 term of 5 consecutive years. You know why this was introduced in company law? To address the threat of the familiarity. Because, like that Rajendra and company and Chaturvedi and Shah, they were doing the audit of Reliance Industries for last 35 years in the Companies Act 1956. Because there was no restriction. Can I earlier could I do an audit of a listed company for 100 years also? Yes, there was no restriction. But it says there is same auditor doing audit, familiar. You were earlier director in the company, now you join the CA firm as an auditor, as a partner. So obviously already you're familiar with the client. So that's a familiarity threat. Right? So you need to identify. You're accepting a lot of gifts from the client. And then client is telling that, you have taken a 1 BHK, 2 BHK flat from me as a gift. And then now if you don't give clean report, I will tell everybody that you have taken a gift from me. So now then that is again, client is intimidating you again. That's the, too sympathetic you will be for the client interest. Right? So that's the familiarity threat. Second is the self-interest threat. Self-interest means you have the fear of losing the client. You say, "Arey, if I give adverse opinion, then this client of mine might go." Or, if I give an adverse opinion, then, they might not increase my audit fee next year. Or, you have a business relationship with the client. Or, so, your business, if you show profit, then obviously there will be good valuation of the business. Or you are thinking of, shutting down your practice and joining there as an employee or a CFO over there. So, self-interest, matlab, खुद के हित में है ना, फॉर योर ओन सेल्फ इंटरेस्ट है ना, व्हाट यू से सेल्फिश इंटरेस्ट, यू आर नॉट बीइंग इंडिपेंडेंट एज एन ऑडिटर. सो दैट्स द सेल्फ इंटरेस्ट थ्रेट है ना. यू इट कुड बी इधर अ, जनरली इट इज अ फाइनेंशियल इंटरेस्ट, और इट कुड बी अ क्लाइंट इंटरेस्ट कि यू डोंट वांट टू लूज द क्लाइंट, और इट कुड बी एन एम्प्लॉयमेंट इंटरेस्ट कि क्लाइंट इज गिविंग यू अ पैकेज ऑफ 2 करोड़ एंड टेलिंग यू ज्वाइन अस एज द CFO. है ना. सो दैट्स द सेल्फ इंटरेस्ट थ्रेट. नेक्स्ट वन, सेल्फ रिव्यू थ्रेट. सेल्फ रिव्यू, आई थिंक डूइंग ऑडिट एंड व्हाट यू से बीइंग इनटू अकाउंटेंसी एंड ऑडिट, यू माइट हैव हर्ड द कंसेप्ट ऑफ मेकर चेकर, कि मेकर और चेकर अलग अलग होना चाहिए. लाइक योर CA एग्जाम पेपर, यू राइट इट, बट कैन यू चेक इट? यू से मैम आई वुड लव टू बट आई एम नॉट अलाउड टू. या यू कैन नॉट चेक इट. वाई? बिकॉज इफ यू चेक इट, यू विल गिव 120 आउट ऑफ 100. And so it has to be checked by another person. And so similarly, say you help the company in the implementation of their internal control. And now you are only doing the testing of their internal control. Nahi, wo kya hai? Self-review threat. Like, Section 144, company law. Section 144? Auditor not to render certain services, prohibited services. If you are the statutory auditor of the company, there is a list of services you cannot provide to the company, holding company, and subsidiary company. like accounting and bookkeeping, internal audit and design and implementation of financial information system, outsourced financial services, investment advisory, investment banking, due diligence, management services, and any other kind of service. Right? So section 144, you remember that, accounting, bookkeeping and all. Why? इट सेज के अगर तुम कंपनी के ऑडिटर हो तो तुम कंपनी को इन्वेस्टमेंट बैंकिंग सर्विस नहीं, नो, यू कैन नॉट प्रोवाइड. व्हाई? बिकॉज इट्स अ सेल्फ रिव्यू थ्रेट, राइट? इट्स अ सेल्फ रिव्यू थ्रेट. मेकर चेकर हैज टू बी डिफरेंट, दैट्स सेल्फ रिव्यू थ्रेट. देन यू हैव द एडवोकेसी थ्रेट. You know, I'm telling you, oh, you know, this cream is very good. Oh, you know, you should always be using this one. Oh, when you use this, you know, it makes your skin so good. Oh, it is so good. There is no cream like that. You know, I vouch for this. And so now I am promoting, or you know, I'm telling you so much. You say, what, ma'am, get some commission or what for selling this cream or what? Is she getting some percentage, 20% commission or what? Why she's so much in favor of, you know, this cream itself? And so what you are doing, you are telling everybody, अरे नहीं रे, you should purchase shares of growth. I am telling you, it will give you 200% return. It's very good company. It's very good. Their financials are very strong. So you are advocating. How your mother advocates for you, no? Okay, no, don't shout at him. Nothing. It'll be fine. Everything. Like advocacy, you know, like you are being the lawyer. You are from your what do you say? From your client side. So you are handling litigations on behalf of the client. So obviously, even if your client has done something wrong, you will try to prove that your client is innocent only. So how you can be independent then? You to know इन्होंने गलत किया है, but now you are handling their litigation. So that's advocacy threat. And you're promoting the share. You're telling everybody, buy the shares, buy the shares. You're handling the litigation. What is that? Advocacy threat. And you're advocating the client. Advocating, you're in favor of the client. That is advocacy, right? And the last one is intimidation threat. Intimidate. To intimidate someone is to scare someone. Threat, to threaten someone. So ye threat kya hai na? Threatening threat. Threaten. Client is threatening you. CA, I will file a case against you with the ICAI. CA, we will reduce your audit fee next year. CA, we will file a litigation against you. CA, we will replace the auditor of the company next year. You say, "Arre, I'm not scared. I know I've not done anything wrong. Why should we?" You see, when you're scared, when you do something wrong, you're scared. Kuch galat kiya hi nahi, to dar kis baat ka? Not done anything wrong. Why you should be scared? So intimidation. Client is trying to put you under pressure. Client is what doing, no? Like last year, what client is doing, no? Last year, your audit fee was 50 lakh. They say, now we will make your audit fee 20 lakh. What they are doing? Ek to increase kar sakta hai, but yahan pe what they are doing? They are reducing your audit fee. You ask, why are you reducing the audit fee? They say, if we reduce your fee, na, then automatically you will do less checking. You will put less man hours for doing this audit. That is why we are reducing the audit fee. So then see, no, means just because you limit the scope of your work, they're reducing your audit fee. And so that's again an intimidation threat. And that's an intimidation threat, right? So these are the five types of threats to the independence of the auditor. What are the five types of threats, everyone? Familiarity threat, self-interest threat, self-review threat. Then you have the advocacy threat and the intimidation threat, right? It's not the Food Safety Standards Authority of India. It is the familiarity, self-interest, self-review, advocacy, and the intimidation threat, right? So step one, what you need to do, you need to identify the threat to the independence of the auditor, right? And then you need to check ki kaun sa hai. Can it be more than one threat also? Yes, it could be all, it could be one, it could be few of them. And so first step, what you need to do is you need to identify. After you identify, you need to evaluate. After you evaluate, you need to address. And after you address, you need to put the safeguards. Right? So IEAS. And IEAS. Right? That is what we need to remember regarding the threats. Right? So IEAS. What is I? Identify. E, evaluate. A, address. And S is safeguards, right? So what did I tell you? What we are remembering over here, independence means we have to check whether there are any threats threats to the independence of the auditor. So I का you take the independence का you take the I, that is in independence and identify. Then after that you have the E and A, which you can see it in the threats का spelling, right? You have evaluate and address. So you have evaluate and address, and then you have the safeguard, which is the last one over there. Right, so from the threats you take the EAS, evaluate, address, safeguard, and independence you identify whether there is any threat to the independence. Right, you identify, and then you EAS, threats में दिखता है ना EAS, so E is what evaluate, A is what address, and S is what safeguard. And to identify, what you have to identify कि which is the type of threat and what are the five types of threats. What are the five types of threats? Good. Right. So, yes, you have the familiarity threat, self-interest threat, self-review threat, advocacy threat, and the intimidation threat, right? So, these are the five types of threats to the independence of the auditor. Right, so what did we discuss? You know, because we had to make it FSS AI, I little bit shuffled them up and down, right? But like if you look at the familiarity threat, what does it say? Long or a close relationship with the client, where you're too sympathetic or too accepting of their work. Your client, whatever you say, I'll do it for you. No problem, client, whatever you say. Right, so it's familiarity threat. Right, then self-interest, you have a financial or an other interest which will inappropriately influence your judgment or behavior. Right, then self-review threat, what does it say? Will not appropriately evaluate the result of a previous judgment made or an activity performed by the accountant or another individual, right? Will rely when forming a judgment as a part of performing a current activity. I told you the crux of it, that the maker-checker concept is getting violated. If you are the maker and you are only the checker, then that's a self-review threat. Right, then that's a self-review threat. Right, then you have the advocacy threat. What does it say? You're promoting the client or the employing organization. Now again, client means CA in practice, and employing organization means CA in service. Right, to a point that your objectivity seems to be compromised. You know why you are so much in favor of the client, or why so much I'm telling you, okay, no, you should use this cream only. Right? So objectivity is getting compromised. And then intimidation, what does it say? Which will deter. Deter means stop the CA from acting objectively because of the actual or the perceived pressure. Right? So client is pressurizing the chartered accountant, attempt to exercise the undue influence over the accountant, right? So undue, you know, just, you know, telling that we'll remove the, change the auditor, we'll file a case against you, we'll reduce your audit fee, we'll reduce the scope of your work, or some, yes, we'll limit the scope of your work or so. Right. So these are the five types of threats to the independence of the auditor. And now they have given some examples of facts and circumstances for each of them, you know, for all the five, right, that might create threats for a professional accountant when undertaking a professional service. So now you see two lists over there. What is the first list? It is for the professional service. And again, you see the self-interest threat, self-review threat. Then after that, you see the advocacy, the familiarity, and the intimidation. This is for the professional service. That means it is applicable for CA in practice. Correct. And the following are examples of facts and circumstances within each of these categories. That means the five that might create threats for a professional accountant when undertaking a professional activity. So this is for CA in service. Okay, when I'm working, say I'm working in Infosys, or say I am working in Tata Motors, or say I am working in Nykaa, anywhere, right? So then what does it say? When undertaking a professional activity, right? So the threat, see, independent, not only CA in practice, CA in service also needs to be independent, okay? Right? So it talks about, so obviously there are going to be different threats, but the threats ka variety same hai, but examples alag alag hoga. And of the types of threats is what? The FSSAI. Right, so over there we talk about now for the CA in practice and then the CA in service, right? So in the exams, will you be careful whether they are asking professional service? Agar professional service hai, to CA in practice hai. Hai ka nahi? Agar professional service hai, to CA in service? No. Agar professional service hai, to it is for CA in practice. Correct. That means it is for your client. And if it is प्रोफेशनल एक्टिविटी, इफ इट इज प्रोफेशनल एक्टिविटी देन इट इज फॉर सीए इन सर्विस, देन इट इज फॉर सीए इन सर्विस. Yes, is it clear to all of you? Let us just quickly go through the list over there. Are you all comfortable, familiar with the terms? Have you got a brief understanding regarding what each of these terms mean? And this FSSAI, it gave you a brief explanation over here. So did you get an idea regarding what do these terms mean? Identify can apply safeguards before occurring any financial loss. What is the difference between self-interest and familiarity threat? Okay, right. So all good. Okay, now I'm able to see your chat box. Okay, right. So I was not able to see it so far. So what is the difference between self-interest and familiarity threat? Familiarity is like I've been doing the audit of the company for last 20 years. Or I know the director of the company personally. So that's a familiarity threat. Okay, but I have the fear of losing the client because say my total receipts of my CA firm is 20 crore and out of that my 15 crore receipt is coming from this client. So I know if I lose this client, the receipts of my firm, it will come down to 5 crore. You understand? No. So that's the self-interest threat. Right, so that's like a financial interest, or you know, the client is giving me the offer to join as a CFO with a package of 2 crore. So again, it's my self-interest. Right, so can it be multiple also? Okay, you're too familiar also because you have a business relationship. That's why there is familiarity also. Yeah, so both would be possible. But that's the point of distinction. When you're too sympathetic, when you are having a long association with the client, that is familiarity. Or when you have some financial or employment interest, then that is the self-interest threat. Okay, right. After you identify the threat, you apply the safeguard before occurring any financial loss. Exactly. So first we need to, so that there is no threat to independence, you apply the safeguard. You understand? No. So that there doesn't come, because once there is a threat to, now you identify the threat, then you evaluate and address it. But going forward, there should be no threat. For that, you put the safeguard. You understand? To address the threat over there. Right, so we'll come to, once you see the points for safeguard, you will get more clarity over there. Okay, good for all of you. Did you get an idea of the 5 types of threats? Did you understand kyun do list hai wahan pe? Pehli list kiske liye hai? What is the first list for? CA in practice. And the second list is for the CA in service, because professional service is provided by CA in practice and professional activity is done by CA in service. Right, good for all of you. Okay, right, so let's just quickly go through the list. Right, so self-interest threat, right? So what does it say? Direct financial interest in a client, right? So you have some business relationship with the client, right? Then quoting a fee, low fee to obtain a new engagement, and the fee is so low that it might be difficult to perform the professional service in accordance with the standards. Like say you're doing ready to do the audit of a company having a turnover of 20 crore for like 1 lakh rupees. Right? So it will, you won't be able to do a good audit, but just for you to get the audit, you are keeping such a low fee over there, right? Because there is no restriction on the minimum fees. Like, can I do an audit for 1 rupee also? Yes. Can I do it free of cost also? Yes. So, you know, there's no minimum scale of fees which has been recommended by ICAI, right? But if your fees are too low, then that is, again, talks about your self-interest threat. Then again, close business relationship. So if you find this point is very similar to the familiarity threat, right? So that's again your self-interest, because you're having a business relationship with the client, that you're doing some partnership, some trading of goods with the client. And that's because of that business, you know, if I give an adverse opinion on the financial statements, it will affect the business also, right? So when you have a close business relationship, then access to confidential information that might be used for personal gain. So again, the same classic example of the insider trading can be taken over there, right? Then discovering a significant error when evaluating the results of the previous professional service performed by a member of the accountant's firm. That means last year another partner was doing this audit, and now this year you are the partner assigned to this audit, and what you find out, okay, last year whatever auditor, this partner, the earlier partner had done, that there was some wrong reporting he had done. But now you know, okay, if I find out regarding he's from my firm only, it will affect the interest of the firm, and it, you know, it will affect the goodwill of the firm. So I'll not mention. So again, it's in your own self-interest. Right? Again, it's in your own self-interest. Okay. Right? So that's the self-interest. Then after that, this is for CA in practice, right? Keep that in your mind. The first examples which we are discussing are for the CA in practice. Then self-review threat. And a maker checker issuing an assurance report on the effectiveness of operation of financial system after implementing the system. तो पहले तो सिस्टम डिजाइन करके दे दिया, फिर अब उसका इफेक्टिवनेस चेक कर रहे हो. नो, यू अंडरस्टैंड, मेकर चेकर हैज टू बी डिफरेंट. देन हैविंग प्रिपेयर द ओरिजिनल डेटा यूज टू जनरेट द रिकॉर्ड्स विच आर द सब्जेक्ट मैटर ऑफ द अश्योरेंस एंगेजमेंट. दैट मीन्स यू प्रिपेयर द फाइनेंशियल स्टेटमेंट्स एंड नाउ यू आर ओनली एक्सप्रेसिंग एन ओपिनियन ऑन देम. Right, so that's the self review threat. Right, I think when you read the example, that itself makes it clear once you understand the meaning of each of the type of threat. Right, then advocacy, promoting the interest or the shares in the company, acting as an advocate on behalf of a client in a litigation, or lobbying in favor of legislation on behalf of the client. Right, so that means you are taking the client side and you are in favor of the client, even though if your client is wrong. Right, so that's the advocacy threat. Right, then you have the familiarity threat. Right, close or immediate family member is a director or officer at the client. So you say, oh, this company director, I know him personally, or he's my relative only. So that's again a familiarity threat. Right, familiarity. इसीलिए तो company law में there is a disqualification ना. 141(3)(f). What does it say? Relative is a director or is in the employment as a director or a key managerial personnel of the company, then you cannot be appointed as an auditor of that company. You are disqualified. Right? So close or immediate family member who is a director or an officer, or director or officer of the client, or an employee in a position to exert significant influence, having recently served as the engagement partner. Right, so earlier this fellow was working in your CA firm. Now he quit your CA firm and he joined that company as a director. Right, so obviously he is very familiar with your CA firm, and you know, familiarity threat is over there. Right, an audit team member having a long association. Right, so same firm doing the audit for a long period of time. Right, so that is the familiarity threat. Then you have the intimidation threat. Intimidation, threatened with dismissal. So client is telling that we will change the auditor, or feeling pressured to agree with the judgment of the client because the client has more expertise on the matter in question. This might happen when you are not you don't maintain and attain and maintain your professional competence. You don't know IFRS. You don't know how the accounting treatment is to be done. Then you have to agree with whatever the client says. Client says, I know I have done the IFRS course and I know how the accounting is to be done. Right? So then you say, okay, you know, you are great. So that's like you are getting intimidated over there. Right? So professional expertise, being informed that a planned promotion will not occur unless the accountant agrees with an inappropriate accounting treatment. So promotion over here means like a fee increase, right? That the fee increase will not happen unless and until you agree with the wrong accounting treatment or the inappropriate accounting treatment. And accepting a significant gift from the client, like I told you, a 1 BHK, right? And being threatened that the acceptance of the gift will be made public, right? As such, we are not allowed to accept gifts and hospitality from the client. So you, the client gives you one BHK and you say, no, we'll not tell anyone that, you know, I've got this flat from you. But then later on, client starts threatening you. Okay, now if you don't give a clean report, we'll tell everybody that you have taken a 1 BHK from us as a gift. Right? So that's again intimidation threat. Okay. Right. So clear to all of you, these are all the examples for the CA in practice. Correct. Now we come to the examples for the CA in service. Right. So now for CA in service, so in for CA in practice, we use the word client. For CA in service, we'll be using the word as the employing organization. Right, so the company, the employer basically, right, where you are working. Right, so what does it say? Self-interest, holding a financial interest or receiving a loan or a guarantee. Right, so self-interest, what did I tell you? It could be financial or employment interest, right? So here it's a financial interest, or incentive compensation arrangement, right? So you are, what do you say? You are going to get 1% of the net profits and you are in the accounts team. You are preparing the profit and loss account. So obviously you will try to keep the profits as higher as possible because that higher will be the 1% of the net profits. Right? So that is participating in any incentive compensation. Then having access to corporate assets for personal use, right? So one of the type of fraud which happens is the misappropriation of the assets, right? So you can use the laptop and the vehicles and all of the company for your personal use. So that's again your self-interest. So that's why you say, okay, whatever the employer says, let me agree to that, right? And offered a gift or a special treatment from a supplier of the employing organization. So you're, you know, you're working in a company and the say you're working in Tata Motors as a chartered accountant in service, and then some vendor supplier of Tata Motor is sending some low quality goods, but he has given you a nice, you know, what you say, 20 gram gold biscuit over there, you know, 24 carats. So then that's why you think, okay, no problem. I will tell that the goods are of good quality, which have been supplied by the vendor, right? So that's again the self-interest threat, right? Which is there for CA in service. Then self-review threat. That is again, when you are doing the, yes, accounting treatment after doing the study for supporting the purchase, the feasibility of the purchase. Right, so first you did the study, okay, whether this purchase should be done, and after that now you are only doing the accounting of it. No, you should have not checked the feasibility, then you can do the accounting. So again, these two responsibilities need to be segregated, they need to be divided. Okay, then advocacy threat, having the opportunity to manipulate the information in a prospectus, right? So company is coming up with an IPO. You are working on the IPO of the company, right? You are in the accounts department, and whatever information is being published in the prospectus, you are manipulating that information. So manipulating means again, you are in favor of the company. You're taking the side of your employer. Okay, right? So that's the advocacy threat. Then you have the familiarity threat, being responsible for the financial reporting. Financial reporting, the accounting of the employing organization. When an immediate or close family member employed by the organization makes decisions that affects the financial reporting. Right, so you have the MD of the company, and you are yes, what you say, very, you're the MD of the company is your relative, okay, is your, you know, say some uncle or so, and you are working in the accounts department and preparing the financial statements over there, right? So now whatever uncle says, you know, you said why you did this accounting treatment, uncle said. So why uncle? Because uncle is family. So that is why it is the familiarity threat. Right? That's why it's the familiarity threat. Then again, long association with individuals influencing the business decision. That is coming for the familiarity threat. And the last one which we have over there is the intimidation threat, right? So intimidation. So professional accountant or immediate or close family member having the threat of dismissal or replacement over a disagreement. So they are telling you that we will, you know, lay off, right? That we'll remove you from the job if you don't agree with this accounting principle, or if you don't prepare the financial information in a particular manner. Remember, we are talking about CA in service, right? So you're working, so you're from the client side, right? You are from the, like, you're working in Tata Motors. If you do the audit of Tata Motors, that is CA in practice, but you are an employee over there, right? So that's the CA in service, right? And attempting to influence the decision making process, for example, for awarding the contracts or the application of accounting principle, okay, to whom the contracts and the vendor contracts are to be given, or what accounting treatment is to be done, right? That is being influenced. Okay, right? So in your senior is influencing, like say the management, the CEO of the company is influencing. So he is influencing you. That means it's an intimidation threat. Right? So you are coming under the pressure. Oh, my boss is telling how I can't listen to my boss. If boss says I have to do it, and so. So that's called as the intimidation threat. Right. So everyone, right? Is it clear what discussion we had? Right? With ICAI, you never know. They ask you a full question on the threats to the independence, or there could be a question regarding any one of the threat, like, you know, familiarity threat for CA in practice and CA in service, or there could be a question like which is there in the question bank also, like self-interest threat versus self-review threat. Okay, what is the difference between these two types of threats? Okay, right. What did I tell you? First thing, what you need to do, you need to identify the threat. After identify, you need to evaluate. After evaluate, you need to address. And after address, you need to safeguard. I hope the sequence is clear to all of you. right, that the sequence is fine for all of you. Okay, now identification ho gaya. Now you need to evaluate that whatever threat is there to the independence of the auditor or of the employee working in a company as a CA in service, whether that threat is at an acceptable level. Hello, whether that threat is as an acceptable level. Like, if I want to do the audit of Growth Limited and I am holding a share, so no, I cannot hold a single equity share. But my relative is holding a share. But my relative is holding a share only of the face value of rupees 2000. Now, what do we say? Relative company law says can hold share up to the face value of rupees 1 lakh. Right? So, though there is a threat, the threat is at an acceptable level. Okay, or I want to do the audit of Growth Limited and my uncle is working in the R&D department of Growth Limited. Now, had my uncle be working in the finance department of Growth Limited, it would have affected the independence. But my uncle is working in the R&D department of Growth Limited. How it is going to affect the independence? So, though there is the threat is at an acceptable level. Who should think that the threat is at an acceptable level? Again, RITP. What is RITP? Reasonable and informed third party. An acceptable level is the level at which a professional accountant using the RITP test would likely conclude that the accountant complies with the fundamental principles. What happens? No, when your independence is impaired, when your independence is affected, you cannot comply with the fundamental principles. That is, you can't maintain your integrity, objectivity, and so on. Right? So that is why you need to check if, in spite of the threat to the independence, you say reasonable informed third party says that it is at an acceptable level, that still you will be able to comply with the fundamental principles. Right? And reasonable and informed third party, what does it say? They would reach the same conclusion that would be reached by another party. Right, and what did I tell you? That RITP, that reasonable and informed third party, need not necessarily be a chartered accountant over there. It could be any person who has the knowledge and experience to understand and evaluate the appropriateness of the accountant's conclusion in an impartial manner. Right, so very important, this is a new concept which has come in independence regarding the RITP, that is the reasonable and informed third party test. Okay, right, then after you address, evaluate the threat. Now you evaluate, and then after evaluation, you come to know that no, that threat is not at an acceptable level. Right? So, first, what you do, you identify the threat. Then, what you evaluate, whether the threat is at an acceptable level. If it is an, how do you check whether it is an, at an acceptable level? By doing the RITP test. Right? By doing the RITP test. Okay, but say after doing the RITP test, you come to know that no, the threat is not at an acceptable level. Now, what you need to do? You need to address the threat. And to address the threat, you can do one of the two. Either you can eliminate the threat or you can reduce the threat to an acceptable level. Eliminate. Simple example. Again, company law disqualification. I am holding an equity share of Growth Limited. One equity share, single share. Can I do the audit? No. So what I do? I sell the share. So once I sell the share, then eliminated. The threat is eliminated. Right? So what have I done in that case? I have eliminated the threat. Or what you can do? You can reduce the threat. Say my relative, say my brother is holding 1,20,000 face value shares of Growth Limited. Then can I do the audit of Growth? No. So what I tell my brother? Okay, 1 lakh share you keep, only 20,000 shares you sell them. Right, so what am I doing in that case? I'm reducing the threat to the independence. Right, so either you eliminate or you reduce. Sometimes, like if I am holding the share, I have to eliminate it only. I cannot reduce it. But in some cases, I can reduce the threat. Like one of the article in your firm, in my firm, say example, I have to do the, my firm has to do the audit of Growth Limited. And one of the article of my firm says that, oh, my uncle is the finance director in Growth Limited. Then now there is a threat. Then what you do, you tell this article, you will not come on this audit. You don't come on the audit of Growth Limited. So what I have done, I've eliminated, I've reduced it. And I've managed the threat over there. Right? So you eliminate or reduce the threat. But you say, no, you're not able to eliminate the threat. You're not able to reduce the threat. Then what you need to do, one, if you've not yet accepted the audit, then you need to decline the audit. And if you've already accepted the audit and now you've identified any threat, then in that case you need to withdraw from the engagement. सो डिक्लाइन और विड्रॉ, बिकॉज आई टोल्ड यू वंस टर्म कि इंडिपेंडेंस इज नॉन निगोशिएबल, राइट? इंडिपेंडेंस ऑफ द ऑडिटर इज नॉन निगोशिएबल, राइट? सो एलिमिनेट और रिड्यूस, इफ यू कैन नॉट एलिमिनेट, यू कैन नॉट रिड्यूस द थ्रेट, देन यू नीड टू डिक्लाइन और विड्रॉ फ्रॉम द एंगेजमेंट, राइट? सो एड्रेसिंग द थ्रेट, राइट? हाउ डू यू एड्रेस द थ्रेट? इफ इट इज नॉट एट एन एक्सेप्टेबल लेवल, यू नीड टू एड्रेस इट. हाउ टू एड्रेस इट? ईदर बाय एलिमिनेटिंग इट और बाय रिड्यूसिंग इट. रिड्यूसिंग इट बाय पुटिंग द सेफ गार्ड्स. वॉट आर द सेफ गार्ड्स? वील सी, राइट? एंड इफ यू कैन नॉट, if you cannot eliminate, you cannot reduce, then what you need to do? Decline or end the professional activity, right? Decline it. That means if you've not yet accepted, don't accept. And if you've already accepted, then end it. That means you need to withdraw from the engagement. And then you also need to put the safeguards, right? To reduce the threats, you put the safeguards, right? So what types of safeguards you can put, right? So again, safeguard always involves putting more people in your team, having more people or different people involved in the audit, right? So it says assigning additional time and qualified persons, right, which might address the self-interest threat. Entire audit, you know, I might have some financial interest, but it's not only me who is doing the audit, there are 20 other people with me. Right, so then the self-interest threat is safeguarded, it is taken care of. You understand? So that is additional time and qualified personnel. Then even though if I do the work, some another person checks the work. So that is the appropriate reviewer who is not a member of the team. Rather, later when we study SQC, Standard on Quality Control, we study a concept over there. Okay, listed entity, before you sign the audit report, you have to get an EQCR done. Have you heard this term before? EQCR, yeah, the engagement quality control review, right? So EQ, getting an EQCR of the audit file done, even that's an example of a safeguard, right? Appropriate reviewer who was not a member of the team is again to use, it will address the self-review threat. So they are also mentioning what is the safeguard and what type of threat it will address, even that is being mentioned. Okay, what is the safeguard and what type of threat will be addressed. Then using different partners and engagement team with separate reporting lines for provision of non-assurance services. Like say you're doing some consulting work for the client also. So let it be done by another team in your firm. Like say, example, like Deloitte India, it has 600 partners. So one of the partner is doing the audit of Growth Limited. So let not that partner do the consultancy work for Growth Limited. Let some other partner in the firm do the consultancy work. Right, so that there is again a safeguard to the independence. Then involving another firm to perform or re-perform part of the engagement. So probably doing a joint audit, or you know, branches being audited by the branch auditor, right? So involving another auditor, right? Even so, that's what I said, you put more people in your team, you involve more people, so obviously that will reduce your threat, that will put a safeguard to the threat of the independence of the auditor. Right, and separating the teams when dealing with matters of a confidential nature might address the self-interest threat. Like say you're handling some matter regarding some litigation, some discussing some matters regarding litigation or so. So you're specifically taking care of that this is discussed only amongst the three members of the engagement team and not all 20 members of the team or so. Right, so you're separating the teams. Right, so that is the safeguards to the independence, right? So how to, so one, you need to eliminate, to reduce you need to put the safeguards, and we just talked about the examples of the safeguards to the independence of the auditor, right? The safeguard, right? How to safeguard the independence of the auditor, right? So very happy that we have completed with one huge part of our discussion over there, which is regarding the ERII. What is ERII? Ethical requirements including the independence, right? Ethical requirements could also be referred to as the fundamental principles. Is it clear to all of you? Right? 100% assurance that you will not forget whatever we have discussed today, right? All clear, crystal clear. Did you get the discussion? Okay, chartered accountant code of ethics requires them to comply with certain fundamental principles. Chartered accountant in practice, in service, need to be independent. For independence, you need to identify whether there are any threats to the independence of the auditor, and then you need to eat those threats. Eat. Because he said, na, evaluate, address, and then T is silent, and then safeguard. And then we said, identify. Right? and the five types of threats: familiarity, self-interest, self-review, advocacy, and the intimidation threats. And what were the fundamental principles? Integrity, objectivity, professional competence and due care, the confidentiality, and the professional behavior. Right? Clear to all of you? Okay. Right. So you have a few questions over here. Right? So let us see the like this is the story, but probably the sometimes you know there is no relevance of the case study they give over there. The question is only in the last type over there. The safeguard is a way to address the threat by reducing the threat. Correct. So it is a way to address the threat by reducing. So not eliminating. So eliminate तो anyways खत्म हो गया. So safeguard की जरूरत ही नहीं है. But if you have to reduce it, then for that you need to put the safeguard. Right? And going forward also, like when you're doing audits and some consultancy work is to be done, you'll say let it be done by a separate team, let the review be done, involve more people in the team. So that will lead to a situation के threat आए ही नहीं. So that's what you put it as a safeguard over there, so that the threat doesn't come on. Right? All good? All of you? I'm so happy and glad that now I'm able to see you at least on the whatever your contents on the chat box. Right, so the audit team is preparing to conduct the audit for ABC for 2020. The audit team has not received its audit fee for the audit concluded. The audit team might be tempted to issue a favorable report so that ABC company is able to secure a loan to settle the outstanding fee. The audit team is not compliant with the fundamental principles of auditing, hence hindering the auditor's independence. ठीक है. Explain the types of threats that may hinder, affect, stop an auditor's independence while issuing the audit report. Simple, you have to write down the five types of threats to the independence of the auditor. Right? Then distinguish between self-interest from a self-review threat. Then fundamental principles which are to be complied. And then one question asked over there is the specific safeguards which you may introduce in your work environment to ward off, you know, to take care of such threats. Right? So you see the format of the book, we see the content, and then immediately we get to see okay, what type of questions have come in the exam regarding the same. And regarding what type of questions have been asked by ICAI for the same. All good? Right? Is it a good start? Technical part, forget it. But apart from that, right, has it been right? Nice? Yes, how many of you remember how many chapters did I tell you about today? How many chapters did I tell you about in module 1 and 2? And then how many standards I told you and how many new standards have been added? Let me see how many of you remember about it. Yeah, some of you remember very well, no? Yes, do you remember what we discussed? Oh, yes, we have 19 chapters. Amazing. 46 standards. Wow. Very good. Right? 46 standards. Yes. And earlier it used to be 36, and now 10 standards have been added. Right? Right now we are studying the last chapter first, which is professional ethics and the liabilities of the auditor. Okay, 1 to 11 in module 1 and 12 to 19 in module 2. Perfect. Okay. Yes. Right, so let's proceed. NOCLAR, right? That's the next discussion which we have over there regarding the non-compliance with the laws and regulations. Right? So NOCLAR, we will discuss it at a later point of time. I don't want to discuss it, you know. Let's have some further discussion regarding ethics and then come to NOCLAR. Right? So NOCLAR part, I'll come to that later. This responding to NOCLAR was the question asked in the May 23 exam, that how do you respond to a NOCLAR? Okay, so yeah, see that question is sitting over here. You know, so NOCLAR पढ़ा, फिर NOCLAR का question है. एकदम set है ना, मतलब it's all set over there. Okay, Right, so the no clear answer is over here. Then now let's come to the membership of the institute. Okay, right, so membership of the institute, when you can become, what type of a member of the ICAI, and all of those discussions over there. Yes, so can you tell me, okay, when you can apply to the institute for membership? Yes, who can be a RITP? RITP could be a, what do you say? It could be another CA in your firm, or it could be another professional, like say a cost accountant or a company secretary, or it could be the CEO at the client place. So any person who could be having an, who could be aware and who could have reached the same conclusion which you would have reached. Right? So those could be the examples. Generally, it's the CA in the firm, but it did not be a CA like that. Okay. Yes, so right, let's come to the discussion regarding, yes, regarding when can you apply to the institute for your membership? Right, when can you apply? Today? How you can apply today? Tomorrow? No? Then some of you are saying on 17th July or on, like 17th Jan. You're so confident about your results, okay, ma'am, jis din result aayega, usi din I will apply to the institute for membership, get my membership number from the ICAI and all that. Yes? When can you apply? Yes, after you've completed your CA final, both groups cleared. Then after you've completed your articleship, then you've completed your GMCS. Your general management communication skills course, residential course, whichever course you do over there, and right, all your self-paced learning modules and your ITT, advanced ITT, and all of that has been completed. Then, so mainly you need to complete your articleship, CA final, and your GMCS, and then you can apply to the institute for the membership, right? And once you are You apply to the institute for membership, your name is entered into the register of members, right? So ICAI has a register of members in which your name is entered, and then you get your membership number from the institute, right? You get your membership number, like, so my membership number is like 144805, right? So you get your membership number from the institute, right? Your name is entered into the register of member. Now, once your name is entered into the register of members, you become an ACA. ACA, that means you become an associate chartered accountant. Right, you are an ACA, an associate chartered accountant. And if you are an associate chartered accountant in continuous practice for 5 years or less than 5 years, but which is being equivalent to that of being in practice for 5 years, so that the executive committee of the council has been decide can decide. Okay, though it is less than 5 years, it's like you've been in practice only for 2 years, but it's equivalent to that of being in practice for 5 years. That is rare exceptional case, but normal kya hai ki you if you've been practicing for more than 5 years, then you become a FCA. That means you become a fellow chartered accountant, right? You become a fellow chartered accountant, right? So you have the associate chartered accountant and the fellow chartered accountant. Are you getting that? Right? So for fellow, you have to get your COP. Right, so if I only so you need to make if you want to practice, you need to make two applications to the institute. One, you need to apply for your membership, and second, you need to apply for your COP, that is your certificate of practice. Right, then in your CA office, you need to laminate and put all those framed ones over there, inter result, final result, and then membership certificate, and then the COP. You would have seen that in your principal's office over there, right? All these certificates and results being put over there, right? So if you are in CA in service and you've just say your name is entered into the register of member, then you are an ACA. And continuous practice for 5 years, then you become an FCA, or less than 5 years, but equivalent to that of being in practice for 5 years, that is decided by the executive committee of the council. Then again, you can apply to the institute for being an FCA, that is a fellow chartered accountant. Okay, right. Then after that, what does it say? Whether you are an ACA or an FCA, or whether you are a CA in practice, or whether you are a CA in service, you can always use the prefix CA before your name. Right, so CA, whatever, like CA Aarti Lahoti. Right, so you know, whatever is your name right now, like I can see so many names over there at the chat box. But generally, I avoid taking names in the class because you know, later on, these same lectures going to Google Drive. So those students are not able to associate with the names which I mentioned. So I, you know, earlier I used to do that, but now preferably I don't call out any names. But like, say, your name is Neha Joshi. Example, there's no Neha Joshi over here, but I'm just saying. So right now you are Neha Joshi, but on the day of result, and you'll become CA Neha Joshi, and you'll become CA Neha Joshi. And right now you are watching the laptop or the mobile, but on the after the results come, it will be CA Neha Joshi, which who will be seeing the what you say computer. Obviously, then you won't be seeing the audit classes क्योंकि उसकी तो जरूरत नहीं रहेगी, but some probably you will be looking for the campus placement by then. Okay, right? So in that half CA also the Amazon Prime, what it has, they say, you know, that Neeraj Goyal, and so that CA Neeraj Goyal, he's waiting for getting that CA before his name. Okay, right? So irrespective of the fact that whether you are in practice or not, you can use the prefix CA before your name. Right? Using CA before your name is not your degree, that's your title. Like if you see it in the case of the doctor, they write Dr. Anil Mehta and then MBBS or BDS या MDS जो भी है. तो ये जो MBBS लिखते हैं नाम के बाद, that's their degree, right? This doctor is not the degree over there. But similarly for CA, Aarti, and then after that I write ACA. So this ACA is the associate chartered accountant, or the FCA if I write over there, then that's the degree after the name. Before the name, it's the title, it's the prefix which you put before your name. Okay, right? Clear to all of you? Right, associate chartered accountant and the fellow chartered accountant. Yes, clear. Right, so obviously once you become an associate member of the institute, so till the time you become a member of the institute, you have pay your registration fee, you have to pay your exam fee and all, right? Then after you become a chartered accountant, then you need to pay your annual membership fees to the ICAI, right? So associate membership fee for chartered accountants is below the age of 60 and not holding a COP, 1500 plus GST, and fellow, you know, that you've been in continuous practice for 5 years and you've become a fellow chartered accountant, so then 3000 plus GST, right? Say you are an associate and having a COP, then 5310. You are a fellow and also having a COP, so then it is 3000 plus 4000, and more than 60 years of age, then associate and fellow. And obviously, though, if you're holding a COP, then situation 2 applies. So, anyways, that's just a briefing for you. Okay, associate member ka kya hai fir. So, you have to pay your membership fees to the ICAI. You have to retain. It's like a not a subscription, but it's like a renewal of your membership fees. If you don't pay your membership fees by the due date, then your membership gets cancelled. And then, if it you, however, if you pay it within the same year in which you made a default in the repayment, then they restore your membership again. But if you don't pay it for a long period of time, your name is removed from the register of members, right? Your name is removed, right? So you have to pay your associate member, depending upon. So you have three fees basically: associate membership fee, the fellow membership fee, and the COP fee. Right? So whatever applicable, accordingly you need to pay the fees. Okay. Right. Then, so this is when you become a member of the ICAI. Now we need to see ke when you cannot become a member of the ICAI. Ke institute says nahi, हम आपका नाम नहीं लेंगे हमारे रजिस्टर में. वी वोंट पुट योर नेम इन टू आर रजिस्टर ऑफ मेंबर्स. ओके, राइट. वेन विल दे नॉट पुट योर नेम इन द रजिस्टर ऑफ मेंबर्स? सेक्शन 8 है ना. सेक्शन 8 इज डिसएबिलिटीज फॉर मेंबरशिप. व्हाट डज इट से? इज डीबार्ड, मींस स्टॉप्ड, है ना, रिस्ट्रिक्टेड from having his name entered into the register of member if he is not attained the age of 21. Right, so at 19 and a half only you cleared your CA final. Say you were in first standard when you were 4 year old only, super intelligent child, And nowadays schools don't take, earlier they used to take, you know. So yes, so then it says no, but if you're till the time you don't attend the age of 21, you cannot become a member of the ICAI. Though you clear your exams and all of that, but membership nahi milega. 21st birthday फिर केक का नहीं, फिर ICAI मेंबरशिप. ओके, देन अनसाउंड माइंड है ना, रैशनैलिटी ऑफ माइंड इज डिस्टर्ब्ड एंड नॉट साउंड माइंड, अनसाउंड है ना. एंड नाउ नॉट दैट दिस पर्सन दैट पर्सन इज सेइंग ए यू आर सो अनसाउंड, ए यू आर सो अनसाउंड. नो, हु शुड से दैट यू आर अनसाउंड? कॉम्पिटेंट कोर्ट एंड स्टैंड सो. इवन कोर्ट सेज अरे हाँ ये तो अनसाउंड है रे बाबा. अनसाउंड माइंड माइंड एंड स्टैंड सो एडजस्ट बाई अ कॉम्पिटेंट कोर्ट. Right? So anybody just says, oh, you are unsound mind, how you are applying to membership? No. Unsound mind and stands to adjust by a competent court. कि court में साबित कर दिया है कि ये person mind sound नहीं है. This person doesn't have a sound mind. Right? Then it says out. No membership of the ICAI. Then if he is an undischarged insolvent, okay, you know, insolvency proceeding, you know, you did some business, some share, some lottery, some business you entered, and insolvent you become, and your insolvency proceedings are not completed, they are going on. That means you are an undischarged insolvent. It says, no name being entered into the register of member. Second, you are a dis the fourth one, you are a discharged insolvent, but you have not obtained a certificate from the court that your insolvency was caused due to misfortune without any misconduct on your part. It says, no name to be entered into the register of member. One, less than 21 year, ruk jao, 21st birthday tak. Right? Then after that, what does it say? Unsound mind and stands that stands so adjudged by a competent court. No becoming a member. Undischarged insolvent, no becoming a member. Discharged insolvent, but he has not got a certificate from the court that his insolvency was caused by misfortune. It says, bad job. If you got a certificate from the court, then no problem. Okay, your insolvency was caused due to misfortune without any misconduct on your part. Then can you get the membership? Yes, then you can get the membership. Or he is convicted by a competent court. So convicted. Not necessary that imprisoned. He is convicted. Means court has said, by what does it say? Within or outside India, of an offence involving moral turpitude and punishable. So not necessarily that he is punished. Not necessary that he is put behind the bars. It may be said that you are, you know, to be put behind the bars. That is punishable with imprisonment or for an offence not of a technical nature committed by him in his professional capacity, unless in respect of the offence committed, he has been granted a pardon or an application made by him on this behalf to the central government, which has removed the disability. Right? So convicted by a competent court for an offence involving moral turpitude. That means you have been a part of the terrorist team, some ISIS team, and some, you know, Kassab and Laden and Virappan and, you know, some particular, I don't know, all those, you know, different terrorist teams or so. It says, please, bhai, you don't become a member of ICAI. And also convicted by a competent court for an offense, right, involving moral turpitude and which is punishable with imprisonment. Right, punishable with imprisonment unless and until you've been pardoned by the central government, which has removed your disability. Or you have been removed from the membership of the institute because of being guilty of professional or the other misconduct. Right, I told you, no, there are two types of misconduct, professional and the other misconduct. Right, so if you're guilty, it says, ouch, no, your name, no into the... So this, ye jo disabilities hai, this should not be attracted when you're applying for membership. Okay, when I'm applying for membership, I should not be an undischarged insolvent. And say when I applied for membership, I was not an undischarged insolvent. But later on, I became an undischarged insolvent. Then my name will be removed. So one, if it is already there, it will not be entered only. But it's already entered and then there is a disability, the name will be removed. And obviously before the name being removed, an opportunity of being heard will be given to the member. Right? So time to look at the clock. Right, so time to say a goodbye for the day. Right, it's been a wonderful session. So I was curious, you know, how many ever batches you've taken. It's always an excitement about a new batch starting and that too for the new syllabus over there. Right, so thank you so much for making a decision for doing the audit class through this platform. And right, looking forward for a wonderful we'll be together for a long time over here, right? Studying the entire subject of audit, and you can pass on the message to your friend and convey your honest feedback, right, to me also. So anything that needs to be improved, convey to me. Anything which you probably appreciate, you can let others know about it. But anyways, think about others later. First, you have to become a chartered accountant, वो ज्यादा इंपॉर्टेंट है, राइट? सो आई विल एनक्रिप्ट द पीडीएफ ऑफ द बुक, आई विल पुट इट ऑन द सॉफ्टवेयर, सो वट एवर वी हैव स्टडीड टूडे यू कैन जस्ट गो थ्रू इट. एंड टुमोरो, टूडे इट बींग डे वन, आई गेव यू एन इंट्रोडक्शन ऑफ द सिलेबस, ऑफ द नोट्स एंड ऑल ऑफ दैट. टुमोरो स्ट्रेट अवे वी कंटिन्यू विद आर डिस्कशन ऑन द end of the section 8 disability, see the question and then move on further in our discussion of the, we'll come to the first schedule by tomorrow, right? So that's all from my side, and see you all tomorrow. Have a wonderful day ahead. I hope that your day turns out to be productive and very, what you say, effective, fruitful day for all of you, right? And you don't waste your precious time, right? So looking forward to see you all tomorrow morning, 9 a.m. sharp. Till then, bye bye. Right, and YouTube also, tomorrow also, for one more day we'll be having the live streaming on YouTube, and then after that it will be only on the portal. Okay, so.